Welcome back. You're watching Morning Express, and today we have former Deputy Speaker Farah Maalim joining us as we discuss, or rather dissect, the speech that was given by President Uhuru Kenyatta yesterday during the Madaraka Day festivities. It was a digital ceremony for many, but of course what happened was transmitted to you, and you did hear what the President had to say, and one of the key elements were constitutional change and why it might be necessary at this point in time. And of course, welcome back. Farah Maalim, you are coming to us via Zoom, and of course being a part of the conversation, I'm sure you kept up with that particular speech. And one element that stood out for many was the possibility of constitutional change. My question to you would be, as we begin this discussion, do you think this is actually necessary and key to the changes that we all hope for example, the end of violence after elections?
Well, I think that inclusivity itself is going to take a lot. We had a system which was more or less like an imperial presidency, and it was the winner take all. Somebody has 50-point-something% of the votes, and the other one has 9.567, whatever it is, but you don't have any power. And I think that's not a good system. It's really, really worked against this country. And of course, you have a very powerful office, more or less like an imperial presidency. And there is need to mitigate that, yes. I think it's going to unite the country in pretty much a big way. Mm-hmm. What happened in if you get the proper new, what do you call it, the constitutional dispensation in this country, this is a very, very divided country. We have a state, we're trying to become a nation, the Kenyan nation. And it's important we have a system that essentially is tailored towards our own environment here and our own situation here, that more or less gets everybody to feel that he's part of this country and to appreciate that. Under the current constitution, the way elections were conducted in the past in this country, and the way power itself was exercised, that never shown. That had never been the case. It's been that you either lose and lose for good, or you win and basically you are there to enjoy the fruits of the country itself. To the exclusion of those ones who ran against you. So I'm happy with a system that essentially is going to be more or less like a grand coalition. We've had that before, and I think Africa needs things like that, because this competitive politics for us is difficult to separate competitive politics and development and inclusion into the national cake.
Right, but at the same time, this also are some of the elements that are put in the BBI, and what is going to be that, some of the elements then of change that are going to be brought about by the BBI. And do you think now this was a push by the President in that direction, trying to bring our focus back to the BBI proposals and what they could do for the country moving forward?
Absolutely. There are two occasions that I think would go down in the history of this presidency right now, and Uhuru Kenyatta. One was as a minister of finance, when he made a very, 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 brought in a very good budget that was pretty much national, that in the 10th parliament, and that's where he got a lot of the mandate and the hopes and the support of Kenyans from. And secondly, it's this BBI. This BBI, and in both cases, it does show massive inclusion spirit. So I think the BBI will come to pass, and Kenyans are going to basically vote for it. And I think it has to go through a referendum, because it alters fundamentally the power structure in the country. And I think that's basically where we are going right now. And I think he's going to leave behind a legacy. He will leave behind a history. And it's only going to be fair and appreciable, I mean, with all its imperfections, that he is there also to more or less midwife it, at least for a couple of years. So I think we are, for the first time in almost 60 years, the likelihood of this country getting pretty much more united than it's ever been, even during the colonial time, because the colonialists worked very hard, yes, to try and create this unity. It was divide to rule. Mm-hmm. But then subsequent governments all more or less had a similar, what do you call it, a system that was their system of governance. So I think we're going through a crossroad, and this is going to be good for our children and grandchildren, I think, in my opinion.
Right. And so when you listen to that particular speech also, you see that the President was making some references to writings by the former VP Jaramogi Oginga Odinga, as well as Tom Mboya. And these, whoever wrote that speech was trying, in a clever way, trying to bring out some of the president's wishes through the words of people who have been politicians of the past. But these are people who are usually associated typically with Raila Odinga. Is this a sense, do you get a sense of unity, the new post-handshake Kenya politically right now from this particular address?
Look, let me tell you, I think people have not read the history of the two men.
Yes.
Those were two Kenyans and they were Pan-Africans in both cases.
Uh-huh.
The mistake we have in this country right now is that we never read history. We never read history. Tom Mboya was the only black man who, as a trade unionist, stood shoulder to shoulder with Martin Luther King to go and fight for the black consciousness in the U.S.
Yes.
And was there on that, you know, when they went to for that big, big, what do you call it, demonstration, and the million men would march to Washington, D.C. to fight for the black emancipation. He was there in Africa as a trade unionist and pushed very hard for this Kwatu, I think it's the Central Organization of African Trade Unions. The man has was a bigger man or a figure. He was a giant in his own right. He was a Pan-Africanist. He was a Kenyan more than anything else. He was not elected from Luanda. He ran in Nairobi. He won an election in Nairobi. He fought for the independence of this country and the release of Jomo Kenyatta.
Yes.
Jaramogi had an opportunity or a possibility of becoming the president of this country or the first prime minister.
Yeah.
He didn't do it.
Mm-hmm.
He's the one who went to the extent of saying, Kenyatta is our God. He was not looking at selfish individual interests.
Right.
And by the way, I am one of the so-called orphans of Jaramogi because I served with Jaramogi in that first multi-party, modern-day first multi-party parliament. Too bad. He left us too early.
Yes.
But for the short period, a few years we were together, he left a mark in our minds and a legacy we will never be able to forget. And the country and the continent needs to appreciate both of them. So I think he took them out as the two outstanding political thinkers of the last century and who are both Kenyans.
Yes.
And that, in my opinion, is what was more than anything else. It was not to try and bring Raila close and say that we appreciated this law. No, there were Kenyans who were never appreciated, who were never appreciated. And I think for once, I am able to appreciate in a big way the statesmanship. Well, not more than once, on a few occasions, but the statesmanship of the current president himself. He brought those things out because they were there to unite this country.
Absolutely. And as we speak about some of the things that they stood for, Mboya warned Kenyans against constitutional rigidity. He told us that a constitution is not an end in itself. It is a means to a greater end. And this is what he said. And therefore, if it's not working, then there is a need to change it. But while there's that need, do you think this would be the right time for that sort of change? Is Kenya...
Yes.
Better place,
yes.
in the right place for that sort of change?
I'm glad we have somebody who was a kid and a toddler in the corridors of power at that time when all these things were happening, when Jaramogi was fatally shot by a fellow Kenyan, and this is the president we never got. Tom Mboya, he was a kid. I'm talking about Uhuru Kenyatta.
Yes.
His father was at the helm. When Jaramogi was put in detention and, you know, he resigned as a vice president because of all the shenanigans of politics, he was there as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
This is a man who now has brought about, in my opinion, the healing of the country. And it goes in many ways. And being the son of the first president, in some cases, who is seen to have betrayed both of them, I think it's a very, very good thing. And to quote them for what they were, and to celebrate our own heroes, because if you don't celebrate our own heroes, who is going to celebrate them for you?
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's a landmark, it's a very powerful crossroad, and I really appreciate that our president has decided to be this, what you call, giant right now, who is going to unite this country for us to deal with our all historical issues, such that we can have a new page. And Raila having also been brought up in those corridors. By the way, I've been with Raila for God knows about almost 6 years now. At the back, in the final analysis,
yes,
you have the man is not a tribalist. Take it from me.
Mm-hmm.
put it somewhere. He is not a tribalist. He's a nationalist in every sense of the word. He has, you know, in terms of policies, in terms of tact, in terms of lots of things, none of us is perfect. But at the end of the day, what I know myself is that wherever there was an inclination to try and create a tribal divide in the country, mm-hmm. he was one guy who would never do that.
Right.
The Central Province was seen as one area that never wanted him to go for the president, just like his father also had more or less a similar tribulations, and just like Jaramogi also. Mm-hmm. But at every time in the history of Raila, there were good, powerful figures from the Central Province, from the mountain region, who were very close to him.
Okay.
And everybody that I know of, Krai Tumrungi, Gitobi Mangyara, Paul Mitya, many people there. And look at every nomination he used to make, and the people he sends also to certain places. It's there's always been the national element, the nationalist element in Raila, and he's one guy who I think should have an opportunity to be there within the power structure itself, to give us some kind of inheritance, basically, that we can move forward from here. And this is the moment. I mean, he doesn't have much more time left for him to be an active politician. And I think this is the moment. The next maybe close to 10 years is where he has to be there to see what he can do. This country to heal. And the camaraderie between him and Uhuru, which to much devoid of selfish politics, in our opinion, is to be appreciated.
Okay. Honorable Maalim, now when we look at the number of issues and priorities that are top on the list of the president, on the president's list of priorities, the economy is one of them. COVID-19 has not made this easy. And of course, there are many other issues that he has been facing, pushing for infrastructure. And other elements that came out during the speech was quite huge. And the railways also were something that he actually tried to explain why they are necessary and how even the economy and the towns and cities that we have today were as a result of the railway that was put in place back with the colonial powers. So when you look at him speaking of a nation that drew from itself for itself as one of the goals of independence, or rather the goals at the time we earned independence, what do you think it implies in terms of his him moving forward and how he would be able to achieve some of these goals going forward, even though, as you have put it yourself, time could be running out for the president?
That's why I think, that's why I kept on emphasizing the fact that he does not have to leave. If he has to leave a serious legacy, it's my opinion, in this new dispensation, both him and Raila have to be around at least to see to it, to see to it that there is what you call implementation to the letter, with all the goodwill of the new dispensation that we are going to create in maybe a couple of months from now, before the end of the year, because we'll have a referendum. Let's not make the mistake we made in 2012, getting rid of the people who were the kingpins of this new constitutional dispensation we have, and leaving this document itself to be implemented by people who outrightly opposed it. Mm-hmm. So in a sense, I think there is, in my opinion, I'm talking about nationally, I'm talking about the future of this country. There is need for both Uhuru and Raila to hang around here a little bit longer, to see to it that the fruits, just like Lee Kuan Yew, just like any other, Mahathir Mohamed, you know, people brought back Mahathir Mohamed at the age of 93 the other day to sort out issues in the country. Mm-hmm. I think the need for them to be around a little bit longer. I agree. And that. Well, as for the railways, yes. I went to school myself in a national school not far from here, and in the early 70s.
Right.
And I remember very well those students who used to come from the four corners of the country, particularly the ones going to the Coast Province and going to the Western Kenya and a number of other places. Those days it used to go all the way to Nanyuki. Paying, that used to be the mode of transport. The friendly, the African who was colonized for all this time, the Kenyan, that was the mode of transport that was friendly to them. We'll go third class, they used to call it, and pay 3 shillings or 4 shillings to go all the way to Kisumu and back again after the end of the holidays. Mm. So the railway has been a pivotal, has been a very powerful factor in the economy of this country, and opened up this country also to the countries in the region, because it was initially called the Uganda Railways. I don't know if you remember about it. And that essentially, and with the port of Mombasa, yes. The only thing is that it has to be done in such a manner that you do not also destroy road transport and other sectors of transport itself. We don't have to promote the railways at the expense of a sector of the economy. We have to see how the two of them can complement one another, and we can then go into the economies of scales. Mombasa is a port right now that is doing less than Djibouti is doing in terms of the traffic that's there. The Ugandans and the Rwandans and the Burundians and even Eastern Congo are changing to Tanzanian ports.
Yes, yes.
Well, they're getting their things. So we have a system that essentially failed to appreciate that what is commercial is commercial. It's business. People look at where they can save coins, where they can save cents, shillings, and money. So we have not been that competitive both in terms of service and in terms of also our cost. And I kept on complaining about these things myself for a number of years now. And people keep saying, no, they'll come back to us because we have better service than Tanzania. No, things are changed. This is not in the olden days when Tanzania was a socialist state. And that more or less was one of the reasons why they could not effectively compete with us, because they were using Ujamaa and we were an open market. Now everybody's an open market.
Yeah.
So essentially what we need to do is to have a serious reforms in KRA, in Mombasa Port itself, to make sure that we are on the competitive edge.
For sure.
People are relocating to those other countries for their transit cargo. And with the customs union, people used to come to Kenya to come and buy Ugandans, to come and buy from Garissa Lodge and other places, and then take it to Uganda and sell it there. Mm-hmm. Now the reverse is becoming, people are going to Uganda.
Yes.
Goods to bring back to Kenya. Mm-hmm. Because we kept on having the spirit of what they call taxations for the Kenyans who are doing business, bustling business from all the rest of the world. So we're losing. We're losing because we don't have the right people who have the right business mind to help us transform some of this institution, of this government. Yeah.
Now, as we move back to the address by the president, at the beginning of the speech, actually, it was beautifully put that we need to stand up to COVID-19 the same way our forefathers stood up to foreign powers. Did this stand out to you as a way a good way of the president asking the country to actually stick to its guns in terms of the fight against COVID-19? How do you think the country should move forward in terms of this and some of those measures that he did promise in terms of opening up the economy and schools sit with you? How do they sit with you right now?
Well, I'm personally somebody of faith, and I don't like the statements when you say that you're going to defeat a disease, you know? At least add by the grace and the help of God. We don't want to sound like Donald Trump, who stands up there and says that we're going to defeat these things. And then look at what's happening, the devastation, it's having effects. And let's have God also. You know, this is an African society, and we are all people of faith, Christians, Muslims, and all the other faiths that are traditional African faiths that we have here. But I do agree with the fact that we need to up the ante. We need to pull ourselves up. We need to get united. We need to fight these things together, and we will come out of it victorious one or the other. And I have no problem with that. I mean, I entirely agree with that. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to have a national unity in addressing these problems and maintain also, as many people have said, the prayers both in churches and in the mosques and the synagogues for the few Jews we have in the country here, to pray for this country, because that is one thing we've always maintained at all levels. We've always prayed for our country.
Right.
We've always understood the limits of the human being, the human race itself, and invoke the word of God. But that does not mean that we just leave it to God and say that God solves problems. Mm-hmm. We, as we put it, I am willing for us all the leadership to come out and be counted and come up with this very very good, what they call Ministry of Health efforts by Mutahi Kagwe and his deputy, Dr. Aman, and the Mangangi also, Dr. Mangangi. They've done a good job. They've done a fantastic job. What we need to do right now is change what you call the methods. We have to transform the methods. Let's have as much as possible complete what you call testing for all Kenyans. Well, let's talk about 200,000, 300,000, 500,000 tested in every month, so that we know that we're going somewhere, and we know where, what you call test, trace, and isolate.
Yes.
We feed on that, yeah. We go for those things. Mm-hmm. We have to be tested, and once we tested, we know how many people have been in contact with their person who has been tested mm-hmm. positive, and then we trust them, and then we isolate them. That's the only way we can deal with it for the time being, until such a time that hopefully a vaccine is found globally. In which the other thing I want to tell our president and our the political leadership for today is let us put some money into KEMRI and all our institutions. Let also us not underestimate the capacity of our own scientists to come up with these vaccines. I think even if it's a small amount of money, we can always allocate money and probably, who knows, the vaccine might be even from Kenya. That's one thing I think we all. And then the other thing is that let's promote the young entrepreneurs in the manufacturing themselves of the ventilators and all these other equipment that essentially were in scarcity in our country, that we can use our own ingenuity and genius young men and women from our universities to manufacture them also in their own ways. Let the universities be tasked. The president should have put out a challenge to the universities and tell them, in 30 days, in 40 days, I want you to come up with ventilators that are innovations that are very cheap, mm-hmm. very, and that basically do the job as well as any other one in New York or in Paris or in London is able to do. And I think our young people have that capacity. Kenyans are geniuses, I can assure you. We are some of the most in the world. Yes.
Absolutely. And while we were all anticipating that speech by the president to hear what he would say and what he would promise would happen, another thing that many were looking to see was how he would interact with his deputy president, with the deputy president, given all, with the backdrop of all the political happenings that have been happening, have been unfolding before our eyes. And actually, when you look at yesterday's papers, there was that anticipation, while today we are reporting of a possible camaraderie, and of course the body language is something people were looking at, and the chit chat between the president and the DP is also making it to the front pages of our dailies. So I would put it to you, what do you think it means when you look at the events that are unfolding? We see people possibly being punished for being allied to particular factions. But at the same time, when you look at this united front that was presented to us yesterday, it speaks of a completely different story. What does this communicate to you?
Well, I think since the serious chopping started at the Senate, our deputy president has completely gone underground, and he has desisted from all the political fights that he engaged in for since the handshake itself, in which he was out there day in, day out, fighting Raila and other people that essentially were, whatever you want to call them, which I think is a sign that he should have acted and behaved in that fashion from the day go. When you see your own boss go and handshake somebody else and call him my brother and tell him that we will have to come up with a system that essentially is Kenya friendly, you don't go out there saying all sorts of awful things about that kind of relationship. So in a sense, we don't know what it is. Mm-hmm. But I was told about how Professor Mbithi, who was the head of the civil service, sat down and helped Moi in writing a cabinet and massive changes one time. And the list was taken there to the president. The list was there with the president. And he literally picked up his own opinion and every appointment that was there. What the president did is that at the end of it, he also included in a pen, I'm told, is the name of Professor Mbithi, and replaced him with Forrest Quindon. I can't remember who it was that he replaced him with, but he replaced him with somebody. And he was sitting in his office, literally happy that all these changes have been made. When he was told, did you hear the radio that you're also not in the list anymore? And then he picked up what you call the hotline, and the hotline was disconnected. Mm-hmm. So the power at that very high level is a very isolated thing. It plays out in many ways. So you might see it as a camaraderie, but how it's going to translate into invariably in most cases is that you don't take prisoners. And that's how I see It's unfolding in the country right now. So whether it is a graceful and an honorable and exit or not, Kibaki was the same. Kibaki was very close to Moi. He was his vice president for 11 years.
Yes.
And one day, he just hears in the news that he has been replaced by Jasfet Karanja, Professor Dr. Jasfet Karanja. And he was relegated to a ministry. He was made a minister for health.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And everybody told him to resign. This is a spite on your face. And Kibaki said no. Mm-hmm. And he's still the president. And thank you very much for having given me an opportunity to serve you for these years. And I'm willing and capable and still will continue to serve you as your minister. And that's how things went.
So there must be a sense of decorum and civility to all this that's happening despite everything else.
Absolutely, absolutely. You can be with one person right now, you're laughing, and the next thing you know is that you're no longer there. You pick up the hotline. You just find the deadline at the end of it. And that's how power works. It doesn't allow a vacuum. That's how it is. That's how it is, yeah.
Okay, now, team came up with the question of the day today, and we asked 57 years after independence, what do you think ails Kenya? Because obviously we are not where, at an ideal point in terms of all the dreams our founding fathers had for us. So I'd put that question to you this morning, Honorable Maalim. What do you think ails Kenya today?
Look, we were one of the most promising third world countries, newly independent countries, when we got independence. I had an opportunity myself to do part of an MBA program which I had done way back, and the institution that I was doing that twinned up with an institution called Seoul Bridge School of Business in Daejeong in South Korea. South Korean the early president, the man who basically brought in most of these policies that essentially got South Korea where it is, was called Park Chung-hee. He was a general who grabbed power through a coup. Mm-hmm. And he wanted to go all over the world to see how he could kickstart his own economy in South Korea. And he didn't have money to pay for his constituent team. He came and borrowed 800,000 shillings or US dollars from Jomo Kenyatta.
Uh-huh.
That's in the 60s. Mm. And at that time, Kenya was way ahead of South Korea, way ahead of Malaysia, way ahead of Singapore.
Right.
And today the economy of South Korea is 20 times the one of Kenya. 20
True.
Times. It's like 20 Kenya government, and the population is similar. We are about almost 50 million, about 50 million landmass. We have much bigger land ourselves. But basically, okay, we did not far enough. Mm-hmm. But given our own, and you know, at the time when he was doing all the powerful reforms that he was doing, South Korea had only two exports, seaweeds and what was called the comfort women who used to be taken to Japan.
Yes.
I've heard about that.
Yes, yes.
And the remittances they used to do from Tokyo and Yokohama, Hiroshima. But today you can see how South Korea is. It's massively industrialized, one of the most industrialized countries in the world, and how Singapore is. I think we got a few things wrong, a lot of things right. And the one thing that I want to tell you is that the time we got it, our population was just about 8 million.
Yeah.
Today our population is 50 million. So given that pioneering of what you call one population, that what you, the four corners of this country can get education, access to education,
yes.
And the fact that we have the rudimentary what you call health services that we do have right now, that is actually way ahead of many other African countries. Mm-hmm. The fact that we have some of the most educated elites in the country in here, and technical, what do you call it, blue collar jobs, people who can do that. We in our country, the training, technical training. You could say, okay, give credit, we have done a lot, but the potential for us to be like Korea or to be like Singapore and Malaysia is there, and we missed it. So you need a new focus and a new vision to try and achieve that. I cannot tell you offhand the way that do A, B, C, D, and that's how you're going to get there.
Right.
But I can assure you, we have a long way to go.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
We have some good stories to tell. In any case, for once, the only country or one of the only countries in Africa that has never had a military coup.
Yeah.
That had a semblance of an election, even if it was not that perfect election every 5 years since we got independence.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, those ones are not mean feats themselves. They are something to appreciate and to be proud of.
Mm.
And to have the kind of the freedom we have in the country right now. This is a country that you can go out there and say anything you want about the president, his deputy, the prime minister, and anybody.
Mm.
So we have come a long way. We have achieved a lot. Given that we were not a nation before, we were just a state, cobbled together by the colonial government for their own interest.
Yes.
We're more or less trying to get united to become a perfect union now. I think it's a massive achievement that we have to be proud of. But then we have a much bigger potential.
Absolutely.
And if we do the right things, I always used to tell Kenya, look, the Gulf states are closest to us. Mm-hmm. We have better trained manpower in this country than anywhere else in the world. And these people have almost 20 million workers coming from outside the world to come and work in their own, everywhere, industries and service sector and homes and everything. Why can't we as Kenyans fight to have close to 10 million of that? And you will end up with what you call unemployment about UTA in Kenya.
Okay.
And the Philippines has got a whole ministry for diaspora.
Yes.
Whole ministry for employment. Mm-hmm. We know, and these are the kind of things that we need to perfect ourselves and see how we can then move this country to the next level of development. But the opportunity is there. Mm-hmm. The record and the history to be proud of is there. And we still have a long way to go, understandably.
So much potential to be explored. That is Farah Maalim, former Deputy Speaker. Thank you so much for your sentiments and being a part of the show this morning. If you want to know all the details of the speech that was given by the President yesterday, take a look at the dailies. They have illustrated everything for you. But for now, we're going to take a short break. Remember, we asked you to be a part of the conversation by answering the question, 57 years after independence, what do you think ails Kenya? Bring your opinions here to the hashtag KTN Morning Express. I'm Matrix Ingado. Michael's Michael G. Gitonga. Kenya Follow Kenya Gain says dynasties are what ails Kenya. What do you think? We're going to take a short break. When we come back, we'll have more for you right here on Morning Express.